It gives me great pleasure welcoming you to the third lecture in the Paigham-e-Azadi series organized by the School for Democracy and NewsClick on the 73rd anniversary of India's independence. Today's talk will be on the legendary freedom fighter Aruna Asaf Ali by Shri Anil Nauria. This is a very significant series of lectures that is being presented and recorded. In these times of misinformation and deliberate alteration of historical facts, and in this age of maligning falsely those who fought for our freedom and for a future in consonance with our constitutional values, it becomes imperative for us to ensure they are remembered and they continue to guide and inspire us and future generations, and to ensure that they are not obliterated from our history books. We have already seen how Mahatma Gandhi and Pandit Jawaharlal Nehru have been removed from textbooks, and we have also seen the pioneers of modern India, Raja Rammohan Roy and Ishwar Chandra Vidyasagar, being portrayed as cronies of the British Raj active against the people of India. It is these forces of which we need to be vigilant and that we need to fight if we are to keep the dreams of those visionaries who dedicated their lives for the future of India alive. There is much that we have achieved since independence. However, there is still much that needs to be realized, particularly with respect to inequality in all its dehumanizing aspects. Through these talks, we hope to learn from the lives and works of such personalities so that we continue to be inspired and can strengthen our resolve to stay on course, whatever be the obstructions in our paths towards a just and free India. I'm also very grateful for this opportunity to introduce this talk on Aruna Asaf Ali, who I greatly admired and had the good fortune of seeing at close quarters. Apart from being the firebrand who became famous for hoisting the national flag at Gwalior Tank on 9th August 1942, and continuing to be active underground, being a youth icon, trade union activist, politician, writer, and much more that Anil will talk about, I wanted to flag two other organizations that she helped set up that reflected her vision and sense of empathy with the people of the country. She was one of the founding members of the National Federation of Indian Women, which came into being in 1954 with stalwarts such as Renu Chakravarti, Annie Mascarene, Hajra Begum, Anusya Gyanchand, Pushpamboy Bose and others, and was president of the NFIW for 19 years. She was also the founder of Dr. A.B. Baliga Memorial Trust in 1968 that she and Ranjana Ray built up to address the pressing needs of the marginalized in Delhi. This was set up by Patriot and Link magazine, which also she was involved in founding with Edutata Narayanan. It now gives me great pleasure to introduce our special speaker for today, Shri Anil Nauria. Shri Nauria is counsel at the Supreme Court of India and the High Court of Delhi for the last 36 years and has dealt, among other matters, with preventive detention laws, criminal law appeals, public employment, labor laws, constitutional issues concerning powers of state governors, the sixth schedule of the Constitution of India, election laws, land acquisition, land reform, and taxation. He was senior fellow at the Nehru Memorial Museum and Library, New Delhi. He has been writing since the 1970s and much of his focus has been on secularism and the state and on contemporary history, including aspects of the freedom movement in India and Africa. He has contributed to various books and journals, the latter including Economic and Political Weekly, Mumbai, Mainstream, New Delhi, Monthly Review, New York. And I'm sorry, I'm going to say this in English, Identity, Culture and Politics, Dakar and Natalia. Peter Maritzberg. He has been a guest lecturer at several universities, both in India and abroad. One very significant movement that must be mentioned and that Anil had a role in initiating in 1993, along with people like Nirmal Mukherjee and Ajay Mukherjee, Abdul Sattar Saab and Saida Hamid, among others, was after the demolition of the Babri Masjid and the communal violence that it unleashed. This was to bring together the residents of Okhla and the surrounding areas in Jamia Nagar, Ghaffar Manzil, Zakir Nagar, New Friends Colony, Friends Colony, and others together as one collective voice against the spread of hatred and communalism. The work they did was based on the principles of Insaniyat. They belonged to diverse walks of life, faced and dealt with several communal crises over the years, and demonstrated the unity and harmony of all religions. So I now welcome Shri Anil Nauria, and it's over to you, Anil.
Let me say that Aruna Asaf Ali is one of the most fascinating figures of the freedom struggle in the first half of the 20th century in India. And the reason why she stands out is because she was a rebel from the beginning. She was rebelling against the she had been born in a Brahmo family, a Bengali Brahmo family, and which in any case has a tradition of not accepting the usual Hindu restraints. And she then defied her family to, as a young girl of 18 or 19, to marry barrister Asaf Ali, who was already well known. And that story is worth tracing in detail. But that again introduced her to the political life of Delhi, and two influences in Delhi particularly I will mention, that is Rameshwari Nehru and Satyavati, the socialist leader. And then she went beyond those that politicization to such an extent that she then could not even stay within the confines of the political activity of Asaf Ali. So she therefore could not really accompany Asaf Ali on his various assignments, both in India and outside. As independence dawned, Asaf Ali had been chosen as the Indian ambassador to the United States, the first Indian ambassador to the United States in 1947. And this was at a time when India was still undivided. So Asaf Ali represented undivided India in the United States. And Aruna declined to accompany him until India itself, she said, becomes fully independent. She went later to the United States, but she was not comfortable there and returned. And in fact, the day when she was returning and Asaf Ali had gone along with her to the New York airport, see her off, that is the day when both of them got the news of Mahatma Gandhi's assassination when they were at New York airport. And it affected them deeply. And Asaf Ali, Aruna writes, burst into tears. On Asaf Ali's own return from the United States, he became governor of Odisha. And there also, Aruna, because of her own political commitments, could not stay with him very long in Odisha. And finally, when Asaf Ali was appointed India's ambassador minister to Switzerland and was posted in Bern, there again, it was only later that Aruna could join him. And when she did join him in Bern, Asaf Ali passed away on the following day. You know, so that is April 1953. So it is the reason I gave this broad overview was that it was in fact the marriage with Asaf Ali that politicized Aruna. And it was Aruna herself who so radicalized her position that she could not then remain within the confines of the political process which was developing in India. That is, you know, there is a work by Lenin called State and Revolution. And Aruna used to say that to Asaf Ali, that you are the state and I am the revolution. So, you know, the reason why I've mentioned all this right at the outset is to make the point that Aruna's is a very extraordinary life from any point of view. And that is the reason why she stands out as a figure worthy of attention in the 20th century freedom movement of India. So this was just by way of introduction. Now I want to go into some aspects of her life in more detail. And you know, I have already mentioned that she was born in an East Bengali family. She was born in Kalka, which was then in Punjab, and now is in Haryana. She went to school in Lahore, where her father was initially working as a journalist, and later in Nainital, where her father had set up a restaurant business. That is where she grew up. And then after her studies, she went and became a teacher in Calcutta at the Gokhale Girls Memorial School. And it was while she was on a vacation in Allahabad that she met Asaf Ali. Now, when they married soon after, and it was a marriage that created quite a stir because it was Hindu and Muslim marriages were not common. And a number of people reacted negatively to the idea of this marriage. Aruna's own father passed away a few months before the marriage took place. And Aruna has written about this whole episode in an article in Patriot, published on October 3rd, 1991. I have this article with me. I wonder if it comes out. No, it doesn't come out directly on the screen. I'll try and scan it and have it sent to you. Now, this is what she says. She names a number of people who, how they reacted to the marriage. And she names her paternal uncle, who said that I was dead. So far as he was concerned, she mentioned some famous politicians. And then finally, she says that when I began to meet Gandhiji after my marriage, I remember that he spoke of it as a symbol of Hindu-Muslim unity. So Gandhi stressed the symbolic significance of this marriage. Now, when she married Aruna and Asaf Ali, they moved to Delhi, which was Asaf Ali's home, Ucha Chelam, Darya Ganj. And it was the ancestral home. Naturally, there were restraints within the home to which Aruna was not used. Asaf Ali offered let us rent another place if you wish to move out. But seeing the fact that Asaf Ali was the only son of his mother, and the fact that he was so deeply attached to her, Aruna did not insist on moving out and stayed in the family home. But she vented her energies in work avenues which came to her through her acquaintance with, initially through her acquaintance with Rameshwari Nehru and Satyavati. Both Rameshwari Nehru and Satyavati were important figures on the Delhi scene. Rameshwari was married to Bijlal Nehru, who was a nephew of Motilal's and a friend of Asif Ali. So it was at dinner, it was at an evening where they were invited for dinner that she first met Jawaharlal Nehru. And she has given us a very remarkable description of that meeting, which I just like to refer to. May I just read out a part of what Aruna Asapadi says here? Excuse me. This was the background to Bijlal and Rameshwari Nehru's inviting my husband and me to dinner at their Delhi home at a time when Motilal and his son, that is Jawaharlal, were staying with them. As we waited for Jawaharlal's return from a speaking tour of some Punjab towns, Motilal instructed the domestics, I'm skipping a few lines to summarize it, instructed a few domestics to keep hot water ready for Jawaharlal's arrival. At last, Jawaharlal burst in, all covered with dust, because he'd come after a big tour of Punjab. He barely glanced in our direction as he went in quickly for a wash and change. He must have thought it was the usual evening gathering of some of the capital's anglicized elite at his cousin's place. I was introduced to Jawaharlal on his joining the company for dinner and was dazzled by the first close view of him. I was wearing a silk sari and some jewelry and might well have struck him as he looked me up and down with amused curiosity as a dolled up slip of a girl destined to decorate drawing room. Rameshwari Nehru must have sensed with womanly intuition how uncomfortable I felt among persons much senior to me in age who were engaged in conversation on matters of state and policy. She came over to me, leaving the circle surrounding Motilal Nehru, and asked me about my family and my interests, and expressed motherly concern about things that are important to a young woman at the threshold of family life. When she thus showed affectionate interest in me, I rushed, as it were, into her embracing arms. And this is how she is introduced to the Delhi Women's League. So this is how she gets introduced to social activities in Delhi, and which then becomes an opening into wider and wider activity. And on the political side, what influenced her was Satyavati. Satyavati was a socialist-minded congresswoman active in Delhi in those days. And Aruna writes, had it not been for Satyavati, I wonder if I would have ventured out of my sheltered domestic life. Notwithstanding that my husband was a prominent congressman who had already gone through the baptism of imprisonment in the non-cooperation movement of the 1920s. You know, now, this year it is 100 years of the non-cooperation movement, which brought about such a major renaissance in India in all fields. Aruna Asif Ali's husband, Asif Ali, had been imprisoned in that movement. So she refers to that. And says, was now again thick in the civil disobedience movement. I had just come out of a college run by foreign missionaries with my westernized habits. I doubted whether I could adjust my way of life and my values to those expected of a Satyagrahi. But Satyavati's burning zeal was infectious. I was drawn to her and could not stay away from the great fight. And then she mentions how they broke the sword laws and they found a marshy land in the Shadra area where there was high salt content, and they would make salt, rough salt, and then option it. And that was Aruna's baptism. She was imprisoned in this movement. There were three jails, at least three jails where she was kept, including Delhi and Ambala. So this is the story of how Aruna's political life begins. And then it continues. But I want to mention one very interesting episode, which is very little known, but which Aruna wrote about in this article which I mentioned, which is not to be found even in the, I don't see it in the compilations of her other writings. It seems that the day in April 1929, when Bhagat Singh and another revolutionary, B.K. Dutt, threw the bomb in the Central Legislative Assembly, Aruna was present in the visitors' gallery. So this is what she writes. She says, "I happened to be present in the visitors' gallery of the Central Legislative Assembly, of which my husband was a member, on the day in April 1929, when Bhagat Singh and a colleague hurled two bombs along with pamphlets with patriotic messages onto the hall of the Central Legislative Assembly." So this is the story of, this is how she was a witness to this historic event. And her husband, of course, was involved in Bhagat Singh's defense. And later on, we have in the same writing some very important information about how, contrary to the impression spread by some films which were produced a few years ago, how Gandhi did intercede with the Viceroy for Bhagat Singh. So what Aruna writes is, Bhagat Singh was arrested and tried not only for this action, that is the bombs thrown on that day, but the earlier killing of a British police official named Saunders at Lahore in December 1928. When he and his colleagues were sentenced to death, Gandhiji interceded with the Viceroy through letters and in person for securing commutation of the death sentence that was passed on Bhagat Singh and his comrades. Gandhiji was unstinting in his praise of the heroes, but also uncompromising in reaffirming his disapproval of the path of violence. So this this is a very historic piece of evidence which came my way when I started looking for material on the subject. And unfortunately, it's not very widely known. Then let me come to another thing. The connection with Satyavati was expressed further in the Satyavati was active in the Congress Socialist Party, which was within the set up within the Congress in 1934, and in 1936 they held their session in Meerut. So there's a description in Aruna Asapati's writings of that session, and how Kamla Devi Chattopadhyay presides over that session, and the fact that Satyavati was chairman of the reception committee. You know, Meerut was considered part of the, that is, the Pradesh Congress Committee included Meerut. The Pradesh Congress Committee of Delhi included Meerut. So Delhi politicians used to have a great interaction with Meerut, and that is how the session was also held there. I should mention that then again in 1940s, We know that she courted arrest in the individual satyagraha in 1941. And of course, it was 1942 where she became a national heroine with the flag hoisting, which she did after the national leaders had been arrested to go, after the Quit India Resolution was passed on 8th August 1942. And on 9th August, the remaining session was to be held when the police came with an intention of breaking down the flagpole and so on. That is when Aruna Asaf Ali and also Usha Mehta, who should not be forgotten, became very well-known figures across the country. After the flag hoisting at Gwalior Maidan in Bombay, the socialist leadership largely went underground. So this included Dr. Lohia, Achyut Patwardhan, S.N. Joshi, Madhulime. And of course, Aruna remained underground until her arrest warrant was withdrawn in 1946. While remaining underground, there were some very interesting episodes and stories. We know that one of the places she remained underground was in Delhi. It is said to be Dr. N.C. Joshi's hospital in Karol Bagh. But I know that another associate of Asaf Ali's, the husband's, that was Indra Vidya Vachaspati, who used to edit a paper in Delhi. I know that she also hid in his house for a while in Delhi. And in Bombay, she was taken to see Gandhiji at Juhu when Gandhi was there in 1944. And she was driven secretly by Srimati Fatima Ismail, who was the sister of a very famous freedom fighter of Bombay called Umar Subhan. So three people we know who were underground in Bombay, Aruna, Achyut Patwardhan, and R.R. Divakar, they went to see Gandhiji at Juhu because Gandhiji was trying to persuade them to come out into the open because he didn't like secret activities. And there is a very interesting correspondence, a very friendly and affectionate correspondence between them on the subject. If I go into that correspondence, it will take a long time. But I want to mention something, another very interesting fact. You know, when Aruna married Asaf Ali, the marriage took place in Nainital, according to a Muslim format. So among the letters that Asaf Ali records in his prison diary as having received is more than one from Kulsum Zamani. Now, very few would have known among those who had been responsible for imprisoning Asaf Ali and others that Kulsum Zamani was actually Aruna. So Asaf Ali records in his prison diary, "Yesterday I received an Urdu letter from Kulsum Zamani written on the 8th of last month." This is recorded on 8th January 1943. So this letter took about a month to reach Asaf Ali. And then there's a further comment which Asaf Ali makes. "She has either bobbed or eaten cropped her hair. So she says, through an artful complaint, skillfully put into a friend's mouth." So she had, in this letter, conveyed to Asaf Ali a hint of what she had done also with her hair. Asaf Ali makes some very interesting remarks about Aruna's nature in this prison diary. And it is borne out also by Aruna's subsequent career. This is what Asaf Ali records. Once an idea has caught her imagination, she rides it to gallop until the tired steed has to be discarded or put to rest. First, the social pony of Saraswati Bhavan. Saraswati Bhavan was the headquarters of the Delhi Women's League, Rameshwari. So he says, first, the social pony of Saraswati Bhavan, trained to perfection, fell from favor, and Irvine College took its place. Then Irvine College faded out, and the women's conference succeeded. One day, the women's conference was abandoned, and journalism followed as the next foray. You know, Aruna had started writing regularly for various journals, including Janata, the socialist journal from which was at that time in Delhi and then later to Bombay. And serious study filled her hours, but the political bias swelled all the time to the point of flood. And now I find that Gandhian politics has invaded and conquered her imagination. The governing passion of the time claims all her energy and time. She is noble to the roots of her soul. And whatever she touches becomes the dedicated devotee's sacred tabernacle. So he was, after all, her husband, and he understood her very well. So the later career of Aruna is also borne out by this, that she would move in support of her the causes that she wanted to reach and fulfill. She would choose varying vehicles and discard them in the seas to, in her opinion, to have effect. So there is a booklet that she wrote at this time. She was a socialist. She was a member of the Congress Socialist community within the Congress. But when the Congress Socialist Party withdrew from the, they renamed themselves Socialist Party, and then a year later they resigned after Gandhiji's assassination. Within a month or so, they quit the Congress. And Aruna left with them. Then she wrote a booklet on the socialists. And this is referred to by Acharya Narendra, the Marxist socialist, who is the doyen of the Indian socialist movement. He refers to, in an article which he wrote in 1951, he refers to this book published by Aruna Asaf Ali. And here he sums up what Aruna Asaf Ali's aims were. And it leads to a very interesting dialogue. But I'll read only the portion where Acharya Narendra Dev tries to sum up Aruna's position. He says, Mrs. Aruna Asaf Ali has recently published a book. She has tried to prove that the Socialist Party of India has given up Marxism. You know, when the Congress Socialist Party was formed, it was formed as a Marxist group. And it gradually, particularly a year after this, or 2 years after this article, actually, it withdrew from a Marxist understanding. But at this time, it had not. And Acharya Narendra Dev is trying to refute what Aruna has written. But before he comes to the refutation, he sums up what Aruna is saying. So I'm reading that portion. Mrs. Aruna Asaf Ali has recently published a book. She has tried to prove that the Socialist Party of India has given up Marxism. Her main attack is on democratic socialism. She has also condemned the foreign policy of the party. She is against the party's participation in the election. You know, in 1951, the general elections, the first general elections in India were about to be held in a few months. And Aruna says that, Acharyaji says that Aruna is against the party's participation in the election. She also thinks that the organization of the party is against the principles of Marxism. In her opinion, the party has ceased to be a revolutionary organization. She considers this party as reformist. She has therefore advised that the party should merge in the Congress. She is also not satisfied with the party she regards as Marxist, for she thinks that the lower middle class in place of the working class has its influence over these parties. So she's critical also of the Marxist parties, the Communist Party, there is one at that time. They are therefore disintegrated. They have failed to enlist the support of the working class. And this, according to her, is their serious weakness. Aruna Asaf Ali has therefore advised these parties to overcome such weakness and re-examine their objectives. She, however, hopes that the Communist Party will ultimately be an instrument of political expression of the conscious working class. But a majority of the working class sees the Communist Party and other leftist parties with suspicion and distrust. Such a state of affairs is bound to continue as long as they do not amend their policies and rectify their earlier mistakes. This is, he's summarizing Aruna. Perhaps this is the reason that Aruna Asaf Ali does not like to join any Marxist party at present. Her group, she had set up a group called left socialist group, was a short-lived group which didn't last very long, and later on it merged with the Communist Party, left socialist group. So Acharya Narendra is saying that this is the reason that Aruna Asaf Ali does not like to join any Marxist party at present. Her group will strive to bring about unity among Marxist parties and will make the working class revolutionary and militant. If this does not happen, how can the working class establish its dominance in a socialist party? With this limited purpose in view, she has decided to set up study groups and joint action committees of trade unions in every factory. In this endeavor, she seeks the cooperation of all Marxist parties. So this is how Acharyaji summarizes what Aruna is trying to do, and then goes on to explain that no communist, no workers movement, communist movement in the world can actually be led just by workers. You will always need intellectuals from the lower middle class to help, and that's a long debate. But I wanted to refer just to the to what Aruna was trying to do. She wanted joint action committees to be set up in, workers committees to be set up in every factory. And she wanted that all parties, all Marxist parties should cooperate in this so that workers' consciousness increases. Ultimately, this left socialist group which she had formed merged with the Communist Party in 55. And she was a member of the Central Committee in the CPI after that, and was also vice president of the AITUC. But the revelations of Khrushchev regarding the Stalinist phase in the Soviet Union, so she continued with her association with a number of organizations, women's organizations, and also media organizations, which have been which she had been associated with, Link, Patriot, and so on. So now I of course I should mention that she was also elected mayor of Delhi in 1958. She was Delhi's first mayor. So all these are very remarkable features about her. She returns to the Congress after Jawaharlal Nehru's death, around the time of Jawaharlal Nehru's death. Now this then starts a phase where she doesn't have so much clout, but she's widely respected across the political spectrum. And when the 1975 emergency, you know, the events leading to the emergency are taking place and the Jayaprakash Narayan movement, she's one of the few who actually sees the dangers of that movement. And she writes about that, you know, the very fact that this movement could lead to a kind of anarchy. And actually, we know now in hindsight that the movement was very heavily impregnated with RSS influence. So then I come to the story of her concluding years. And, you know, the former foreign minister Natwar Singh has a very interesting account of the time after Rajiv's assassination, Rajiv Gandhi's assassination, when the general elections had been held. This is 1991, the summer of 1991. And there is a real possibility that the Congress, even if even if it doesn't secure an absolute majority, would be the dominant party and would form the government. So the question was, who should be the leader of the Congress in Parliament? And because he would then become Prime Minister. And Natwar Singh, the former former diplomat and later foreign minister, he has written in his memoirs that he and Aruna were sent to meet the vice president, Shankar Dayal Sharma, and prevail upon him to accept the leadership of the Congress Party in Parliament. That is, to leave the vice presidency and take up prime ministership of the country. And the reason I'm mentioning this is that she, Aruna's, you know, when the Congress wanted to convey something to a man like Shankar Dayal Sharma, they invoked the help of, they sought the help of Aruna as the president. And when they, Natwar writes that when they went and conveyed this offer to suggestion to Shankar Dayal Sharma, Shankar Dayal Sharma didn't waste a moment to reject it, because he said that at my age, I don't have the energy to take up such a heavy responsibility as that of Prime Minister of India. And so Natwar writes that Aruna and Natwar rode back in total silence, so stunned they were by the fact that this man had just turned down the prime ministership of India. And then it was after that that Narasimha Rao was called to take up the son. But history would have been so different if the suggestion which Aruna had put to Shankar Dayal Sharma, who was a far more secular minded leader, if he had accepted. So, and then within a 2 years of that, of course, Aruna passed away on 29 July 1996, age of 87. One thing in conclusion I want to read out to you, something which Jawaharlal Nehru wrote on Aruna. Not quite on Aruna, but Aruna is... Aruna in 1947 had been writing, she had been writing for this socialist journal called Janata. And some of those articles were put together at that time in a little booklet called Travel Talk. And Jawaharlal Nehru was requested to write a little foreword to it. That foreword was written in 1947, but it reads like you might treat it as a sort of summary of anyone writing about Aruna in retrospect today. So this, I'll read out some extracts, if I may. Jawaharlal Nehru says, I find it a little difficult to write a foreword to this little book. The difficulty is not the book, but the author of the book. How am I to deal with her and her writings? They do not require any commendation from me. It is easy to criticize any set of views in this complicated world that we live in. And Aruna Asafali often says and writes something that is liable to criticism. But that criticism, he says that, you know, there are a number of things I may be able to criticize in Aruna, but that criticism, however justified, would be poor stuff. For it would deal with some superficial aspects of a living, vibrant, and challenging personality who has shaken up many a sleeping person and become in many ways a symbol of these changing times. And goes on, every bit of this forward is worth reading, but I'll conclude here.
Thank you very much, Anilji, for giving us such a comprehensive overview of a very full life in such a short span of time. I'm sure I speak for everyone, and particularly the youth who have been listening, when I say that it was both fascinating and inspiring to hear of the directions Arunaji's political life took based on the people she met during her formative years and her own courage, extreme courage, I would say, convictions and commitment to the freedom struggle and to the idea of independent India. Thank you very much once again.